When Uthman compiled it, yeah. Initially they were written in bones.
Yeah, because it was no paper.
In parchments.
Yes.
In stones. Mm-hmm. In date leaves, date stalks. Any form of writing material mm-hmm. written in. They will be written in as the Prophet have dictated to them.
So right. Yeah.
But there was a compilation under one bound book at mm-hmm. one point. During the time of Caliph Abu Bakr, right?
That part. Yep. Yeah, I understand that part.
We talked about the second compilation where we wanted to, the Caliph at that time, with the consensus of the Muslim, mm-hmm. consensus of the Prophet's companion, mm-hmm. who agreed collectively, this is what the Quran left behind by the Prophet. Mm-hmm. He said, okay, we are going to now unite the Muslims under this reading, right?
Yeah.
Reading. I've heard the story. So this. Copies of this, mm-hmm. very early copies of this, exist. Okay? When you say the very originals.
Yeah, like the one that was written on the bone, for example.
Yeah, some of them survive in museums. I mean, but maybe not be the originals, might be much later on.
Yeah.
I know someone in a book called Short Introduction to the Quran by Michael Cook, who's one of the Orientalists, he gave us an example of a picture of how the Quran was transcribed in a bone and a picture of Surah Al-Fatiha. But how early it goes, I don't know, because I don't remember the exact dating of this. Okay,
but when you say some of them, is some of them missing?
So what happened was, when all of this was compiled, I mean, this needs a real detailed explanation. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise, when I give you a whole jigsaw and some missings, you might not get the full picture, right? I'm only giving you parts of the picture.
Fair enough.
When it was all compiled, through all the primary witnesses, two witnesses for each verse, each ayah, then all of these primary materials were not necessary anymore. Okay? So when it was standardized in this reading, it was all got rid of, destroyed.
So the original, it was recited, for him to memorize.
And transcribed.
And then from the...
And retranscribed.
They've now written it down onto the bone.
No, not memorized. From the written material, mm-hmm. it was retranscribed. Collectively, with the consensus of the Muslim community.
So the original scripture that was written on the bones was then written on paper. Yeah. Is that what you mean?
There are two versions of the history. Okay, one is the second compilation also happened where the Khalif made this edict. Whoever has the Quran that was written down directly in the presence of the Prophet, come along and produce two witnesses that you've heard this. So they all brought down and then it was all written down. But the one who was in the process of writing was ordered, whenever you disagree with the writing because of the dialect, write it down in the dialect of the Quraysh, mm-hmm. okay? Not the dialect of other, for example. So there are people from Medina, the three scribes, and there are one from within the Qurayshi. So it's write it down within this particular dialect, if you want to call it. Mm-hmm. So it was transcribed. So. The transcription happened what way? From the original materials, and then it was checked with the companions who had them recited, and everyone agreed this is it. So once you now have a rewritten transcription from the original writers, authors, or the original scribes who wrote them, and retranscribed, it's still the original, because still this is original.
I get that, but forgive me if this is a difficult question, but like, it's been written on the bones because at that time there was no paper.
Yeah, same bone, yeah? Different
so
materials.
At some point the paper has come in now, yeah?
Much later.
For them to put it on.
Much later.
Now, is Muhammad still about them times there?
No, paper came much later. People transcribing
right, so Muhammad has gone now.
In parchments, in animal skin.
Yeah, so Muhammad has gone and the Quran is still on the bones and skin. This present time.
No. Quran was compiled in every different materials they had.
Yeah.
Okay. They had. What all the materials.
And then
in their hearts.
And then the Prophet passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And it was still on the original, was recited that people have remembered, and also that was written would be on the
writing
bones.
Material was still there.
Yeah?
The writing material. Everything that they had was
bones.
There. Not just bones, everything else,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, just bones, but everything else.
Yeah.
But then at some point now, it's transferred from the bones. No, thank you. It's gone from the bones to the paper.
Mm.
Yeah. Now, how long ago was it that it went from the bones to the paper?
Okay. So we are talking about from the time of the Prophet to the first Caliph. Mm-hmm. First Khalif, his Khalifate was about 2 years or something. I can't remember exactly. Is it 2 years, Khalifate of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu? And then the second Khalif, the second compilation, say about 10, 12 years. Okay, so we're talking about this period. Within this period, the companions of the Prophet who wrote them, they were alive. They were consulted. They came together and they rewrote it and retranscribed it. So there is no risk of the Quran being lost in transcription or in translation, as they say, lost in translation. Because now you have the original recipients who transcribed it are the ones who have produced it again to retranscribe it. And it was retranscribed and read it aloud to them so that they know this is it. From this master copy was made multiple copies, which was then disseminated within the Muslim provinces.
But wouldn't the original still be considered the original? No. I know you're saying that there's parts of it in museums.
When you say original,
like,
remember, when these were written, let me give you an example, right?
Because at one point, all of the bones and skin and everything that was written on, it would have come to one place and then they would have written it again. Yeah? So at the time, it wasn't split about all over the place, was it? Like, you see, like the Quran, obviously they knew it ritual, but they also would have written it down on
the bones. Look, this is one of the very, very earliest transcription of the Quran.
Mm-hmm.
It's most...
On the bone or paper?
No, on parchment. No, people didn't just write on bone, they also wrote on parchments as well, right? Those who are able to... So you can't just focus on bones because there are other materials.
Oh, yeah, sorry. I didn't mean like that.
So now this is something...
Is this in the time of the paper or non-paper?
Before the paper.
This is before the paper?
Before the paper, exactly. Before the paper. So now this is considered to be even the time before the compilation done to standardize the Quran in this particular way that Uthman did, radiallahu anhu. So this is a Quran that was a parchment that was washed away and rewritten over it.
When you say washed away, which
because one? Parchment was very expensive. You have to kill so many animals to produce this kind of leather to write on it.
Yes.
To make one mushaf, how many animals do you have to kill? 30, 50, 100, I don't know. You have to be very rich, right, to even buy this.
Yeah.
So they would reuse it, okay, if necessary. So this one was reused. So what we now have technology with ultraviolet light, lightning or whatever they're using to go and read the undertext. And you can see the undertext here. They finished this one chapter and then he writes it, because every surah, apart from one surah, starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Okay? So he writes Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and then crosses off and says, La taqul Bismillah, and then start the surah. Do not say Bismillah, within the same text. So if this was left, as I mentioned earlier on, and people used and reused to transcribe it, there is a risk that people will consider this part of the Quran. So what Uthman radiallahu anhu did, when he compiled under a bound copy for dissemination to the whole of the Muslim provinces everywhere for public consumption, none of these will be present. No commentaries of your personal copies that you made, none of this will be present. Totally, the only thing will be the Quranic ayah and the Quranic surah, beginning to end. This would not be included. So this was not necessary. So that's why he issued, saying, once this is all done and all agreed upon, that now we have the Quran as the Prophet left behind, everything else should be destroyed.
That sounds a bit suspicious, though.
Hang on. If it wasn't destroyed...
No, but do you understand what I mean, though?
How is it suspicious? Tell me.
Well, because I mean...
Suspicious
the,
what?
If I've got the original copy of this video, and I make a copy, there's no reason for me to deliberately destroy the original copy.
Take my example.
I've just got the copy, just in case I lose the original.
What you didn't include is this example. People were writing within the material that they have their own commentaries. Because remember, these people are the first revelation of the Quran. They are witnessing revelation coming down to the Prophet. And they wanted to ask the Prophet, what does it mean? And they understood it, they would write it down. They're writing down even within the text itself. Because they know that when they read the Quran, they're not going to make a mistake. But someone else they don't know the intention of writing this. It's possible for, like, if I were to read it today, I would say this is part of the Quran, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. They knew. So if that was left behind, there is always this risk. People will consider this is part of the Quran. So what Uthman did, the same people who wrote this, the same people who got in the transcribing process collectively together, and they agreed. So it is not about like making a copy of a copy and something different. No, it is now making another original copy in agreement, in consensus of what the Quran is, and destroying these things which might confuse some people later on.
No, but that's, I mean, why wasn't the final word protected by God?
That's how it's been protected.
Yeah, so therefore you don't need to destroy the
original. No. It's not about leaving. You see, God told us the way we have reliance on Him. One of the examples that the scholars would give, for example, suppose now you've got your horse or your camel, right, whatever, you're there and you want to now have a nap underneath a tree. And you just bought this horse, right? Or this camel, you know, so expensive. And you've gone there somewhere, right? You know, you're in a desert or in a particular area. Now, if you go to a nap without tying your camel and you find your camel, your horse gone, are you gonna blame God or are you gonna blame you? God, our Prophet taught us that having reliance on God in such a way that make your own effort, tie the camel or the horse, so when you have a nap, you'll have a peace of mind. When you wake up, it's still there because you've made the effort. So these efforts are there, even though if none of these were done, Allah will still protect it as He promised. But we have to make this effort because the responsibility also is there to know that there is a risk of some people falling into this confusion.
I mean, I'm not saying that this is what happened,
yeah,
but in most cases, if I have something that I don't want you to know about, and I have the evidence of it, and I want to teach you something different, then I would destroy the original evidence. I'm not saying it happened in your situation.
You see, again, you're conflating the issues. If the compilation was done, which was then made into mass copies and distributed by one man, one person, without consulting the initial recipients, the companions, then you have a suspicion saying, has he done it right?
Yeah.
Has he done it correctly?
Yeah.
He could have just changed something here and there. But this is not exactly what happened. What has happened is the same recipients who wrote the Quran consulted and approved. So if, for example, if there's a text, right, and we all agree that this is the text, so it doesn't matter how many times you rewrite it, if you every time you say, look, write it this way, recite it back this way, this is it, again, because you are the primary
but
witnesses.
That doesn't make sense because the companions would have been around when it got transferred from the animal skin to the paper.
When it was transcribed, as I said, from the second of the narrations, companions were called again. Okay, there's one lesser-known narration, one narration, where they're all asked to submit your authentic, primary, first-hand material that you transcribed directly in the presence of the Prophet. So they came along, and the witness came along, says, okay, this is what was transcribed, I testify. So you have the primary material again in the process. Imagine now this happened the second time, and the third time, fourth time. What's happening? Every time you have the primary documents. The documents are primary, witnesses are primary. So the trust, the reliability, the authenticity, the authenticity, strength does not diminish at all. Because when we talk about the authenticity and reliability and strength of witnesses and documentation, this is of the highest standard. If it wasn't, it's not hope.
Well, we have to
hope. It's not hope. We know for sure. Because it's how it was transmitted.
For sure, because the original evidence has been destroyed.
No, you're saying again. The original evidence, the original evidence, we're together and mass transmitted to the Muslims. And
are
not only that,
the original evidence not, this
only,
video?
Not only this, look, if I destroy this and he records it, I can still resurrect this from back from him,
yes,
his camera.
But the point still remains, are you going to destroy the original? Unless there's something that you're going to alter, for example, yeah? And say like the altar is something disrespectful, just for argument's sake,
yeah?
Then in order for me now to prove that that didn't happen, I'd have to get my hands on the original. Now what you're going to do is destroy the original, otherwise you've had it.
What you didn't appreciate even if I've explained, when they came together to rewrite it under one Mus'haf, right? From some people had parts of it written. They didn't have all of it. Now, from those parts, or from the whole, it's transcribed again properly. This transcription is not such that you'll have any doubt or dispute. This is my point. Because there is no room for doubt, dispute, and error in that transcription. Because all of them are coming with their primary witnesses and agreeing and testifying and approving. So nothing of that doubt.
Said all of them, it would have been like a handful of men.
Look. If each verse is testified by two companions, because this is enough, sufficient as a witness, that this is the Quran. One person brings it, two witnesses. How many witnesses do you need for something? Million? Of course not. So if you have reliable witnesses, trustworthy witnesses, primary witnesses, and now you have this collection from there, we have absolute certainty from them. If it was otherwise, in which, as I said, someone else we don't know who transcribed it, we have no idea where he transcribed it from by himself, you know, in his own room and transcribed it, and then says, there you go, that's the Quran, copy it in mass numbers. Suspicion.
Is it not fair to say that even the person that has transcripted, the one that you speak of, yeah, that he also we have to know his background and what,
yes,
how he is as a person.
Absolutely,
as well.
Yeah? And we do. Okay. We do. We have testimony of how honest, of a good memory, and so on about himself. And he was not the only one. There were other scribes also writing. And from them, they are made into other copies and distributed. And this distribution, remember, we're not talking about where it's distributed 500 years later, within the same time. And what we are forgetting in the discussion is the Quran is also preserving the hearts. Yes. So they have this, and they're reciting. They're reciting audibly in their prayers, in their reading, in their gathering. So whatever has been transcribed, if there was a single error, it would have been picked up immediately. Yeah. Just like today what happens. Yeah. The Quran goes through meticulous checks, and if there's one error, it's picked up and it's rejected, right? So because of this, both graphic and oral, meaning written and reciting memory, went hand in hand, the chance of any error coming in, is not the case. That's why the primary mode of the Quran is memory, because that guarantees its preservation. Secondary is your writing form. But when you have both hand in hand, you cannot, in fact, you know, Ramadan is coming at end of this month.
Yeah,
we're going to fast. What you will witness is most of the countries, including London, in the mosques, the whole of the Quran from beginning to end will be recited in this month. The whole Quran will be recited from memory, without looking at the Quran, from beginning to end in this month. Some finish at 27 days, some 30 days or 29 days, right? Yeah. So, I invite you to visit one of those mosques. One is Regent's Park. There's a Qatari mosque here, there near Hilton or Sheraton, in this park road. In Whitechapel Mosque, called the East London Mosque. And you will see, when the Imam is reciting, we are human, right? Sometimes, even though you've been reciting this for hundreds of times, you might make a mistake. He makes the mistakes. People trying to correct him, but they're told, no. You don't correct him, because it's going to disturb others. Because imagine everyone trying to correct him, because many people have memorized the Quran. He was left to say, okay, people in the front row, let them correct, okay? And you will see how they're correcting. Even as I said, a single letter, if it's pronounced differently, you will get corrected.
This is what we spoke about, though.
Yes, and this is what we mean by preservation of the Quran and transmission.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, I can accept it. I don't have any. It's only when we talk about it not all being kept. Is where I have to. I know you're saying it didn't have to be kept.
I said, but I gave you the reasons why it needed to be destroyed, because of the confusion for the future generations. This particular one, now we've discovered, right?
That's a bit scary.
No, this particular one. Now, if there was no oral form of the of preservation of the Quran, and you got this, you'll say, that's a different Quran. It says something different. So the memory preserved it and said, no, that's not right. Every other Mus'haf, which was standardized and copied, tells you that's not right. That means this particular copy of an individual is his own commentary.
Unless the recitement was different on the skin. Unless the recitement was different on the skin, because it would have been recited onto the skin first.
Footnote, it's not in the margin. Why is it different? Is it a different Quran? You're going to have this question. So things like this exegetical gloss, we call it, or exegetical remarks, yeah. Commentaries, we know they used to write it. We know that. And as I showed you, first time in the history of Islam, as far as I know, first time in the history of Islam, or history of the world, we have now documentary evidence to show to the people that the companions would often write commentaries, their remarks within the text. We knew about this, but we couldn't provide you a documentary evidence. We knew in the hadith, we knew in our biography of the prophets and so on, and you know how some companions to read and they used to write. We knew this is transmission, but there wasn't anything that I can show you physically. When I say evidence, this is what evidence is. But previously, this is our teaching, this is our belief, this is our tradition. Our tradition.
Testimonies.
Yeah, our tradition. But now, our tradition is what? Demonstrated to be accurate with documentary evidence for the first time in the history within 1400 years. Beautiful. First time. Even though we know, you know, this is, we don't know who wrote it, and it's called La Taqul Bismillah anyway, but at least we can appreciate what our scholars talked about because we can clearly see it. So when we talk about the Ahruf, what was destroyed, maybe some of the Ahruf people wrote it, who knows in what form they wrote with their commentaries. So when the Quran was standardized with the consensus of the Muslim, the companions of the Prophet, we know that this is the Quran the Prophet left behind. So when you read it, that's the Quran that you read. We have certainty. So that's why Muslims are certain about the Quran that has been transmitted to us.
You know what, I've really got to go to toilet. I've enjoyed it though.
Take care.
I've enjoyed it.
Take care, man.
We're learning out here.
Of course, of course.
100%, yeah? Cool.
Nice talking to you. You take care.
Take care, bro.